In the 1980s, paddlefish populations were once again noticeably on the decline, particularly in Missouri and Tennessee. During that time, there was an embargo on Iranian imports because of the hostage crisis in Iran. There was also a boycott on Soviet products over the invasion of Afghanistan. These trade restrictions cut off American caviar producers from their supply of the highly prized sturgeon caviar from the Caspian Sea. Producers needed a substitute, something of quality that would pass the test of the social elite, where those salty little black pearls would find the most discriminating palates and the money to back them up. Paddlefish eggs were a likely substitute because they closely resembled the eggs of the Caspian Zevruga sturgeon in size, color, and taste. The potential was there. All that was needed was the right marketing strategy. Before anyone realized, the demand was overwhelming the supply. The price for paddlefish caviar soared, and often sold under the title of American sturgeon caviar in some of the finest specialty stores in New York and Dallas, retailing for as much as $238 a 14-ounce tin, which is the typical weight of a caviar pound. It was still a great deal less than the rare beluga caviar, but held its own with the Russian Zevruga. As is often the case in lucrative ventures, there's the chance of illegal activities, and the beleaguered caviar industry was no different. When the smell of paddlefish turned sweet, the business ethics of a greedy few began to stink. Paddlefish caviar was making news. Articles appeared in major newspapers such as USA Today and the Wall Street Journal. One feature was brought to the attention of federal agents and led them to believe there was a group in Missouri that was illegally commercializing paddlefish roe.
Our first indication that we were having problems in Missouri occurred about 1985, 86, 87, when fishermen began telling us that, hey, all we're catching are small paddlefish. We're not catching the large ones anymore, particularly the females. At least the numbers were going down. Our biological information, our surveys, kind of showed the same thing. It was at this time that a federal and state investigation started.
Supervisory Special Agent Larry Keck with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife's Law Enforcement Division gathered and analyzed intelligence data from several states, all relating to illegal paddlefish commercialization. He coordinated an investigation and assigned two of his special agents to a covert operation in Missouri. Bob Lumadue was one of those agents. He and Special Agent Manny Medina were first to go undercover, disguised as poachers.
These people were serious about what they did. When we first got in with them and got in undercover with them, they told myself and the other agents involved that if they did find out we were agents, that they would kill us. And we had no doubt that they meant what they said. Not only did they all carry guns, but it was very dangerous being out there with them at night on the waters, because we knew that they could simply push an agent overboard and hold them down with an oar, or simply throw a net over them and then just say that it was an accident. These people were in this for one thing, and that was for the money. They talked about caviar as black gold, and they were up there without any regard to the resource or what they were doing to the paddlefish population or anyone who got in their way.
The poachers used long nets with 10-inch mesh as part of their arsenal to rape the rivers. They kept the nets hidden along the riverbank until they were ready to move in, then worked quickly and quietly, stealing through the night, stringing their death traps in such a way they'd seal off an entire arm of the river. The nets didn't discriminate against species. So literally hundreds of big fish were trapped in the nets each night. Catfish gar, and of course, the prized paddlefish. There wasn't time to distinguish males from females during the frenzied search for black gold.
The paddlefish were slaughtered in numbers that at times made myself and the other agents involved sick. Any fish that we caught of any size was slit to see if in fact it had eggs or not.
river turned red with blood.
How many subjects we got?
Got three. I have seen white buckets that appeared to have eggs, and I've also seen a pup that looked like it had a net in it. We got a probable cause.
10-4. Any weapons?
Have not seen any.
10-4. We're to give us a word when they get up out of the water.
Okay.
As part of a joint investigation, Missouri Conservation Agent Steve Nichols was assigned to the case, bringing the total to three working undercover. The covert phase of the operation took 18 months. At takedown, seven subjects were arrested, and 10 federal and state search warrants were served in southwest Missouri.
Eggs over here, Rob.
Got eggs?
Got eggs. There's a net.
Yeah.
All right, guys, be
got
careful.
A gun.
I got a handgun.
Got a gun.
Got another gun.
Another gun.
Here
you go, John. At the close of the three-year investigation, agents had documented some 200 state and federal violations. Suspects from all over the United States had traveled to Missouri for the paddlefish spawning season, intending to spawn destruction on one of our nation's valuable resources, and all for the sake of greed. 23 people were arrested, charged, and successfully prosecuted in state court in Missouri. On a federal level, the U.S. Attorney's Office was relentless in their prosecution and took strong positions on the wildlife charges. Six defendants pled guilty to felony charges of interstate trafficking in wildlife. They were fined and sentenced to time in federal prison. The hard work, dedication, and courage of state and federal officials paid off in a big way. Federal Judge Alan Edgar, who presided over the felony offenders in Chattanooga, Tennessee, was very direct with his response to their surprise at receiving prison sentences. We can no longer tolerate the destruction of our nation's natural resources for the short-term profit of a few.